we go. I saw a countdown.
Yeah. Now, whether or not it says test, I have no idea, right? No, I think it's going to be fine. So, hi, Ed. We're doing an experiment today.
This is cool.
Yeah. Well, and it's because so anyone who ever watches this in the future, the reason we're doing this is because as we were talking yesterday, we're saying, boy, it's just the news for AI goes so fast. You can't possibly like, oh, I'm going to write a blog post about it. By the time the ink is dry, the news has changed. And even if you're using your computer. So this seems like a better way to do things. So I don't know, Ed.
You know, we'll see how that goes. It really
exactly.
Proves to be a better way to do it. But yeah, you know, I think that's the way I usually feel when we get into one of these conversations. It's like, wow, you're so 3 hours ago. That was pre-lunch.
Yeah, what was that? Exactly. Well, exactly. That probably, you know, this has been my, you and I have talked about this, but I've said it and you've listened, is I feel like that this is also a big problem in our industry because there's so much imposter complex. I mean, you know, you can't go into a nerdy discussion and act like you don't know anything. And there's just so much information and it's hard to keep up. It's almost impossible to keep up at this point. So it'd be nice to have these open discussions like we do.
We can give a shot. Hopefully somebody other than the two of us finds it entertaining.
Yeah. Well, we've done this before, like over beers. And yes. If there was a camera rolling at some point, I'm sure it would be entertaining.
Yes, exactly.
Maybe this is a thing. Like during this thing, every time we say AI, we have to take a shot.
I think that would be a mess.
Yeah. Well, have you ever seen Drunk History?
Yes, I have. So we're going to do Drunk AI? Maybe
Drunk AI. I mean, I actually think that'd be pretty entertaining too. Yeah, let's do that. Okay, so you have, all right, just so we can help everyone else out, like what you just turned this on for me. So I have this, but tell everyone about your favorite AI news source.
Oh, well, you know, this is one that's been pointed out to me. So I think, you know, a lot of people are already following this, Ben's Bytes, and it started as a newsletter. And then now there's a website that seems to perhaps be an homage to Hacker News in terms of its design. But if
there's no perhaps, yes. This is totally, this is a ripoff, but that's fine.
Well, yeah. That's cool. But, you know, it's not a bad source if just in case you didn't already need a new constant stream of AI developments, but pretty good roundup.
I made a QR code for it. So, you know, we're also playing around with Restreamer. Restreamer is pretty cool, but I made a QR code if anyone wants to click on it and check it out. So top news today, because, you know, this is June 27th at 2:18 p.m. Pacific time. That may change in a week or in an hour, who knows. But that story, which is like railed right on the top, was this whole thing of Supercoder, which is a sub-project, I think, of Super AGI.
I guess Yeah.
I'm thoroughly fascinated. I mean, you've got a thing for agents for sure. I think that you and I have had some exciting conversations about agents, but this whole thing of going into building large, complicated software projects, that seems like an interesting turn of events for me.
Yeah, it is very cool how quickly these tools are becoming applicable in the software development process. And it's just, you know, I mean, we're old timers, so to me, it's like, it's the coolest thing since Deja News, right?
Deja News. Oh, God. I don't know what you're talking about. It's before.
Yeah, exactly. I have no idea.
But yeah.
Before we started copying everything from Stack Overflow, right? You know, it's like, let's hit Usenet. And and somebody must have solved this already. So.
And Slashdot. What happened to Slashdot?
I don't know. You tell me.
It's still around.
Is it?
It's still around. Yeah. It's just not Slashdot anymore. Yeah. But well, I digress.
Yeah. So, you know, as any good programmer spends more effort finding ways to get somebody else to do the programming for them than doing it themselves. So, yeah, you know, this whole thing of application templates, of agents that, you know, are building software for you.
I get worried about this because, you know, it's like I've used Copilot and it's cool because it does help you whip out a lot of boilerplate.
Copilot's amazing. I mean, with the autocomplete that it does now, with the new version of it is amazing. I haven't started using Copilot Chat yet. I want to do that, but the autocomplete is like sometimes my jaw just drops. I'm like, you know, because you just like type in like a variable name and you're like paused for a minute, and then suddenly it just like autocompletes this whole section of code, and you're like, what just happened here?
Yeah, and it's kind of creepily accurate too. I've added in comments, I was updating the Apache website, the Cassandra website, and I was writing out like ASCII doc, and it was doing autocomplete on that. Like, so if you happen to be reading a blog post on the Apache Cassandra website and you start seeing some really weird words, that was Copilot. So it isn't just code. It's like comments. It's like
Sure. Anything. Yeah. It's even better at the comments.
Yeah. But I mean, see, this is where I'm at with auto-generated code is I feel like there's going to be like this kind of warm gray goo kind of universe that we're in where there's just no new ideas. That's what I don't think that's going to be. And that's going to be my argument for a while. Cause you know, and I was talking to Jonathan Ellis, and you know, co-founder here at DataStax, about his experience when he was building out some vector search stuff on Cassandra. You know, yeah, he was flying through code using Copilot, but the hard stuff was still up to him.
Yeah, but the hard stuff is always up to you. I think there's two levels of hard stuff. There's the hard stuff that's not important and still requires you to go and look up a bunch of stuff and figure out, you know, all of this esoterica. And then there's the hard stuff where you need to be completely focused. And I think that, you know, what we see with you know, whether it's with Copilot or just for that matter, just going into ChatGPT and saying, you know, I want to build a, you know, website that does this and start generating it for me. Like the scaffolding, getting you past the, you know, that first line and is amazing, you know. Mm-hmm. And I've talked to a couple of folks that are out there going and actually doing new startups, people who have gone and previously done, you know, a startup and built a team and done all that just to get to their prototype. And they're like, I can just do it all myself now. Like all that stuff that, you know, I needed the website. Oh, I needed this. I needed that. And like, I started farming it out. And then they're like, I just, you know, I had the whole site built for me and I had all of the, you know, all the pieces that were boilerplate. And that's pretty cool.
Yeah, that's, you know, that kind of analogy is like back in the day, like you and I were both involved in the first .com wave. And like the first slide on your pitch deck was the data center we're going to build, you right. know. And you know, we're gonna go buy a huge sun server and install Oracle on it. That's step one, you know. And that, you know, of course that's like ridiculous now.
Yeah, but step two was always like, and then I gotta go recruit my team, and I would have and you'd go and like, you know, you'd have like your slide deck with like, you know, all of the developers you were gonna need, and then all the developers you were gonna hire just to get to your MVP.
Yeah. And so I think in the same vein, we're at that place now. It's like a pitch deck that says, you know, we're going to hire, you know, a team of starting engineers to get the MVP out or the POC done. That's going to look ridiculous. Like, why are you doing that? You have an idea, go have it generated.
Right. Well, it used to be that, you know, that used to be the whole thing. It was like, oh, I have an idea. In that case, you have nothing. I think there was a Dilbert to that effect. But now, now, sure, you can go from an idea to a prototype.
Well, I mean, that's why I think, like, because Super AGI, they're trying, you know, they are they are pushing the boundary of like, okay, we're a company that makes you do all, lets you do all this stuff. And then Super AGI with their supercoder, you know, I think they're trying to productionalize it. Because my experience so far with projects like AutoGPT and especially GPT Engineer, you know, they're like 0.1 alpha.
Sure.
You got to be ready to put in some debugging work on Python. Perfect example, like GPT Engineer, no matter what you tell it, it really wants to write Python code. It's like, I'm like, no, I want a VS Code. I want to write a VS Code extension in TypeScript.
And it gives you Python. You know, I'm doing a hobby project that is in Verilog, and it has no problem with it. That's a hardware description language you use with FPGAs, and it, I'll tell you, it is not trying to sub in Python. It's actually going and doing really good code that is amazing, because that's not an easy language to do things in.
So what you're saying is there's no innovation left in Verilog. All of it's already stored in GitHub somewhere.
I think so. I think the priors are pretty expensive. I mean, you know, it does dumb things, but it seems to do a remarkably good job of a lot of the boilerplate. I mean, it all comes down to what the priors were at training time, right? And this is one of the things that you and I have seen, because we've done quite a bit of this in terms of query generation for databases, right? Yeah. And, you know, we primarily work with Cassandra, which uses CQL, which is a derivative of SQL, right? So they have a very similar surface syntax. Looks like the cat has made a guest appearance.
I was like, this just made the whole live stream.
I know. we had the live stream, we were like, oh my God, a cat.
Right. Yeah,
we should add that to the headline. Ed and Patrick and Nico the cat.
Nico periodically.
Yes, periodically does his guest stars. But anyway, yeah, look, there's a lot of SQL on the web, right? There's tons mm-hmm. of that code, and so as a consequence, getting a database query written out of GPT, there's been papers written to this effect, but there's a lot of production stuff. And you know, I mean, we ourselves have found that if you bracket it with enough sort of prompt scaffolding around it that you can make it generate CQL, right? You know, our variant of it, just because it's already so good at that. So it's really cool. But that said, anything where there is a large enough corpus of code, you get some amazing results. And, you know, I wish I knew what code was in these models. You know, there's that.
Yeah.
There's that new
question.
Yeah. Well, yes. Yeah. Because you don't know, like, you know, I mean, a lot of these were built with what, Common Crawl, right? Is that the,
that's why I'm like, that's that warm gray goo problem, you know, like,
right.
That, kind of like the maximum entropy in software will be brought about by AI.
Yeah.
It's like it'll start self-referencing, and then it'll be self-referencing the same corpus of code that it looked at originally, and it'll just turn into this common mass. And I mean, maybe that's not so hard. We just like add enough hardware, but I truly worry that if we had agents generating code and doing things themselves, that we would see a bunch of COBOL and Perl.
I think what you're going to see is, I mean, I think it accelerates, but it doesn't change the fact that, you know, if there's a piece of content out there that you put online, it gets referenced and reinforced. I mean, that as a human dynamic, that already happens, right?
Yeah.
We've seen this all the time. In fact, I've been the perpetrator of some of these things, where you go and, you know, if you get a great blog post where you state your point of view, and I'm thinking back to the early days of indexing in Cassandra, that you happen to make a persuasive point with on you know, a nicely formatted blog post, it just becomes the de facto answer. And whether or not whether or not it's the right way to do it. And so the only difference is that the LLM has read the code rather than the human. But humans already, there's already a model in the loop on most programming activity, and that model is the Google search index, right? Like most developers, you know, have Google open in one browser window, and everything that they're trying to figure out, they run a search on, and they find the results, and whatever's in the top three results may find their way into their code. So that piece is not that different than the fact that developers are going going to an LLM, whether they're going to ChatGPT or Bard or otherwise, and like, oh, I'm trying to write this. What's the most efficient way?
I love following the open source LLMs that are just flying out like a chipper right now. On Hugging Face, the leaderboard changes every day. But it's interesting to see the rise of LLMs that are specific to coding. Like they've been trained on coding sets. Yeah. And, you know, that's the whole the fallout with Reddit right now is, they really ticked off a bunch of Redditors, but you know, the Reddit's trying to create this moat of information. Well, GitHub has more valuable. If you look at the dollars per byte of information that you know, like the value of it, I think GitHub has better numbers there, because that's actually usable code. But then will we see like LLMs that emerge that have like a really high degree of speciality? Like this is a Java LLM. So it's fast. And then they'll tell you where they train the set from, you know, I just think that this is where Google could come in, right? They could Google could say, we created an LLM based on all our C code.
Sure.
Or all our Go code.
Well, except that the challenge is that as we know that, LLMs leak secrets like crazy. So are they going to do that? Probably not. The interesting thing is LLMs have basically had their Napster moment. And what I mean by that is that it's all about content and access and distribution and licenses. And this is going to have a lot of consequences. And you've mentioned Reddit, and there's a lot of things going on. They're not the only ones who are locking down their content behind APIs, because again, a lot of these LLMs were built off of the common crawl data set or Google's internal crawl or things like that, right? Yeah. But they took advantage of the fact that there was a large base of content that was perhaps not was very unrestricted in its usage, or the restrictions were based on previous theories of how you do restrictions. In the case of content that you see within communities and such, we already see that. We see Reddit has locked down its APIs. Twitter's locked down its APIs. No coincidence. Those are treasure mm-hmm. troves of content for, you mm-hmm. know, the language and communications and knowledge of, you know, the largest sort of cultural corpus of content, right? So they're gonna protect it just the same way that in the you know, when you looked at Napster was responded to in two ways. One was, of course, they got sued into non-existence. But the second thing was that all of the music distribution switched from physical distribution to streaming. Yeah. The reason why that was done was sidestep the issue of physical access to the data. And what you're going to see now is a similar thing, which is that access is going to be access to content, to databases of content that are considered valuable to the models, is going to be done in a very restrictive way so that, you know, every bit of it is governed by a terms of service or an API license. They're not going to let you, they're not going to let you take the content to train your model. Again, just the same way that post Napster, they said, we're no longer going to, you know, we're no longer going to ship disks that people can rip. We're going to, it's going to be streamed. You'll get it as you need it. And it'll be distributed in a way that's very hard. Sure, we'll get plenty of people coming in and talking about how they rip streams all day long. Yes, I know you can do it, but it's a lot harder. You know, I mean, you and I are of the generation where we took our trunk full of CDs and we're busily ripping them in CD-ROM, drives.
I don't know what you're talking about. That's illegal. Yeah, me neither, I don't condone any of that. So
exactly.
I pay for all of my content.
Yes. Yes. Well, you know, by the time you got into the 2000s, it was a moot issue because nobody had the physical goods, and outside of a very small set of people.
iTunes and Spotify
and Spotify.
I mean, that's all I need right now because I mean, everything is on there, and I pay a fixed fee every month. I think you're right, and that is a fascinating thing. Is like, what's the cost of IP?
Well, so this ties into. So this ties into open source though, because this is where I was going with this. Right. So, and it's really funny because you and I have been people in the open source community for many, many years, but most people in the open source community don't realize sort of the fact that many of the same license protections that we use to make open source viable are the same ones that, you know, the bad guys in the music industry use, right? It's all based on copyright. But, you know, if I can take a piece of GPL code and have an LLM reinterpret it to me, is it still GPL? I don't know.
Yeah, this is going to be a reckoning with open source. I think open source and AI, that's going to be, we're not talking about that right now because... Yeah. There's SSPL, there's GPL, there's AGPL, licenses that aren't they're restrictive licenses, but the code is available.
Sure.
So then what? And like SSPL is probably a good example. You know, it's a BSL and SSPL are the two that I think about because those are very clearly like, no, you can use this on your laptop, but anytime you put it in production, that's a license, right? And a lot of companies have gone that direction just to protect their IP and still have this open source halo about it, but they could get AI washed pretty fast.
Any license. I mean, we're going to see, I mean, one way or another, there'll be some case law around this really quick, but at the moment, I don't know that. I mean, you know, obviously I'm not a lawyer, right? But, you know, and neither are you, but we do know that the LLMs are very good at washing this stuff. The generative art world has been struggling with this, but I do really wonder what it's going to mean. You know, we saw some of the early examples of that where the content, you know, from an autocomplete standpoint and such, you know, people said, oh, it literally grabbed the code from some open source project. Well, yeah, but that's easy to fix so that it's not literally grabbing the code, but what do you do when it rewrites it?
Well, what do you do when it violates a patent by procedural method?
That's going to be in the hands of the people who utilize that. Again, I'm not a lawyer, but if you implement the code that is, if you take something from that's generated by an LLM and it happens that the LLM generated something that is, you know, that violates a patent, that's your problem. It's not the LLM's problem. I think the patent protections govern this sort of thing. But
it doesn't mean we're not going to traipse into it. And that's probably that's my bigger point is that, you know, if you're using Copilot and it's like, hey, here's a really awesome thing for you. And, you know, I know patenting algorithms is still a hot button, but if there's something about that, you know, or you re-implement something that is patented, a library, or just straight up proprietary code, who's liable?
That's always been the counterintuitive. That's a whole can of worms. We could go on for patents and software.
Oh, patent. God, yeah.
Right?
Google v. Oracle. Goodbye.
Yeah, let's not go there. But the reality is that that's always been a landmine. You know, AI or no AI, you can come up with this brilliant idea entirely on your own, implement the whole thing, ship it, and then be like, nope. That's already patented. And you're like, how's that fair? Well, that's the way it works.
Yeah. No, I think you're right. It's going to be case law. Eventually, someone's going to sue somebody.
Sure.
And it will change. It will have some regulation and everything else that goes with it. And that takes me back to my point. You know, like this project, like Supercoder, I think they're rushing ahead fast to get out there because it's interesting, an interesting problem to flesh out.
No, I think it's...
They're going right into the minefield.
I think they'll be just fine. I love this stuff. I mean, I know you do. I'm serious. I think that all of this tooling, I love these things. I love Copilot. These are super cool. Just the level of empowerment, like, you know, when you start working with these things and everything is just humming and you're in the flow and you're building, it is amazing. It's like, you know, it's like pair programming with the, you know, most savvy programmer, you know, that there is, who also doesn't get annoyed that, you know, you're want to listen to different music than they want to do, you know, right? So it's, I think
you need to try GPT Engineer, because that'll change your opinion. Because you can describe what you want.
Yes.
And then you may not be sure exactly what you get out of it. I mean, it is pretty cool. That is a taste of the future, right? I think of like the Jarvis on Iron Man, you know, where you're like, oh, I need some code that'll do XYZ, and it'll just go do it. That's a little more future, but that's what this GPT engineer is supposed to do, is here, write a product spec. And of course, everyone uses a snake game, you know, because that's what I want. But you just write a product spec, throw it in there, and then it uses those prompts to build out all the classes and everything you need. That's not Copilot anymore. That's make my project just poof.
I think it's there. I mean, you know, we stumbled into this when we, you know, not everybody's read your great blog post on Cast.io. I wish they did. We should do that on the next one of these, assuming that we decide this is a good idea and we decide to keep doing it. But to this day, we don't know if it hallucinated out an entire project. I strongly think it did, but it created a whole repository, README file, documentation, and everything.
Yeah.
And, you know,
I think so.
And working code. So I think that's awesome.
You're right. We should tell the story of Cast.io just so it's immortalized in some digital form other than my blog post. Because I mean, those are going to be more of those more stories that are coming. I mean, someone's code snippet that somehow found its way into an LLM all of a sudden became a new product. Right. I think we've talked enough here.
I think we have. I think this was mission accomplished. We did a good stream of consciousness. We'll see whether we'll have to check this out and see how well this turned out.
Yeah, I think we'll see like all two or three people that watch it. We'll ask them. We'll just go around to one to one.
Yeah,
maybe we'll do it again, and we'll need to talk about Mosaic ML. That's definitely on the.
That was a good one. That we could have spent the whole time talking about that. I think we need to do that again in the next
soon.
So very soon, because that one is rife with potential. I don't even know where to begin.
All right, so we have our homework. Let's go build an opinion and come back with hot takes.
Exactly. Cool. All right.
Thanks, Ed. See you, everyone.